All right, this video lecture is on dangerousness and risk assessment. And this is a very fascinating area in which a forensic psychologist can have a big impact. Now think about this. How do you determine if someone is dangerous? And recently I've been spending time in a state forensic hospital, and I've seen some very, frankly, dangerous individuals. Typically they're there because they're incompetent to stand trial or they've been found not guilty by reason of insanity. Some of them have committed horrific, horrific acts, you know, like murder, sometimes multiple murder. And if that individual no longer possesses a threat to themselves or others, theoretically they should be released. So how do you determine if someone poses a risk for danger? I think this is a fascinating subject. So what is a risk assessment? A risk assessment is comprised of judgments of the nature of the hazard, the likelihood of occurrence, and the frequency of occurrence. Also the seriousness of the consequences and the imminence of the occurrences. So what's the likelihood that this is going to happen? And if it happens, how frequently and how severe might the risk be? So think about this in some populations that you probably don't want in your backyard. If someone is a sex offender and they're getting ready to be released from jail or prison, a forensic psychologist might be called in to do a risk assessment. What's the likelihood of this individual reoffending? Okay, there's three predictive schemas that are used in risk assessment. First one is clinical, the second one is actuarial, and the third one is anamnestic. So these are the three predictive schemas that are used. Some people use all three, some people use just one. So what's the first one? These are clinical predictions. These are based on clinical experience and judgment. Now, if you ask me if I use this, obviously, when you're interacting with an individual, you might have gut feelings based on your experiences in the past. But what is this about? Now, it's not just subjective. There's something more that you can do. In interviewing individuals, you can assess specifically for risk. Now, the two things that you're going to be looking for are suicidal behavior and homicidal behavior. Those are like the two most important things to look at. So you can use your clinical skills and interviewing skills and elicit the information from the individual. And the three areas that you really look at are suicidal or homicidal ideation. So you ask the individual if they're, you know, have you had any thoughts about hurting yourself or hurting someone else? Which is really a difficult conversation to have if you think about it. And it's bizarre when you start asking people those questions. And I gotta tell you, you know, I have asked, you know, a lot of people these questions in the past, and it's shocking to me how many people actually have suicidal or homicidal ideation. A whole lot. Now, the next level is their plan. So do they know what they would do? So I've talked to a lot of people, no, you know, I think about killing people all the time. You know, oh God, I'm so angry. Well, do you know exactly what you would do? Have you thought about it? No, I just have that angry feeling, you know, I just feel, or maybe, yeah, you know, I think sometimes I might be better off dead, but no, I've never really thought of a plan. I don't know what exactly I would do. And then the third level is intent. So what is the likelihood that you're going to do this? Do you intend to do this? And here, sometimes I ask things a different way. I might say, so what's keeping you from hurting yourself? And there's just different clinical ways to elicit this information. But this is really important. You want to use your clinical skills to do this, and you can generalize this schema to other areas. Now the next thing is actuarial predictions. And what we do here is we attach specific statistical weight to different variables which assess risk. So you might look at, oh, there's so many different variables you could look at. You could look at age, sex, diagnosis, previous criminal history, you could even look at medication, stuff like that. And what we want to do here is base this on statistics. So the idea here is that if accuracy of prediction is to be the most important factor, it's best to find out how a member of a comparable group of individuals conducted themselves over time. So you want to look at individuals that have similar demographics or histories or whatever variables you're interested in, and you want to follow them and see how that individual fared as far as risk. And unfortunately, this takes a long time and a lot of research. So it involves painstaking follow-up research of a particular group over set periods of time, like longitudinal research. It's a little difficult to do. But here, when you make your risk assessment predictions, it's based on statistics. Now the last one are, actuarial predictions. What are some possible limitations to this methodology? And if you really think about it, there could be a lot of limitations. What if you have individuals that don't really meet the criteria that the research studies have been based on? Can you generalize to those individuals? So here's Eric Harris and Dylan Klebold, the two young men that perpetrated the Columbine massacre. So think about those two individuals. And if you do this, and you're basing your predictions based on statistics, what you might have is false positives or false negatives. Now, we've already gone over that. But what if your predictive schema says, yes, this individual is a threat and he is dangerous, when in fact that individual actually did not possess a risk of danger? The more dangerous is a false negative. So you have somebody that comes in and you use the actuarial schema to predict dangerousness, and you say, no, this individual isn't dangerous, but he's in that 5% that actually are dangerous. So some things that we do to assess for this is called the HCR20, or the historical clinical risk. This is an example of a tool that would be used by forensic psychologists. I see this all the time in the forensic hospital. This is just kind of on the chart. So a clinician goes through and they score these sub areas, 0, 1, or 2. And based on the total score, you can get a predictive measure for risk. So we have historical items like previous violence. That's very important. Young age at first violent incidents, relationship instability, psychopathy, personality disorders, clinical items like lack of insight, negative attitudes, impulsiveness, and then risk management items like plans lack feasibility, or exposure to destabilizers, lack of personal support, non-compliance with remediation attempts, and then stress. And so you add these up, you get a total score out of 40, and then there's like cutoffs for final risk judgment, and here they have low, moderate, and high. And boy, I'll tell you, I see a lot of people that are high risk according to the HCR20. And we can also use the psychopathy checklist by Robert Hare, which we've talked about in the past as well. There's another one called the VRAG, and this is a violent risk appraisal guide. And this is, they have 12 actuarial items here, their scales, which has been widely used to predict the risk of violence within a specific time frame following the release in violent, mentally disordered offenders. So you have these tools. You can use your clinical skills, but you can also use these actuarial methods. So your basis of risk assessment is made in statistical methodology. And then anamnestic predictions are basically based on the case history of the individual. So you go to their chart, you review their psychiatric chart or their medical chart, and you look for a history of previous violence. And if the individual has that, you make your prediction based on that. So really, when we're looking at risk factors for violence, There's static, dynamic, and risk management predictors. Those are the three broad categories that we look at. Static means like it doesn't move. It's static. It's stuck. Dynamic means that things can move around and change. So static risk features are features that an individual has that are historical events that cannot be changed. So it's something that's happened to that individual and you cannot change that. Now, dynamic risk factors are things that change over time in situations. So let's talk about like substance abuse. If someone has a substance abuse history, that's static. That can't go away. A dynamic example would be intoxication. Is the person drunk right now? Can that change? Yeah, because that individual's hopefully gonna sober up at some point. So something like a history of mental illness would be static. Current hallucinations or delusions would be dynamic. And then risk management predictors focus on the environment or the nature of the situation in which the individual will live in the future. So if somebody goes back to a neighborhood, they're exposed to other people committing crime, weapons, availability of victims, stuff like that, that falls into that category. So here are some of the static risk factors that we look at. History of prior violence. I mean, if you remember anything from this, just circle this. Write that down, history of prior violence. That's the best indicator of future violence. Young age, at first violent act, or just young age altogether, those are both very important. A younger person is more likely to be violent or aggressive. A history of relationship instability or hostility. A history of employment instability, drug or alcohol abuse history, a major mental disorder, a diagnosis of antisocial personality disorder or psychopathy, early maladjustment at home or school, a history of attempted or actual escapes from secured facilities, a diagnosis of any personality disorder. So those are things that people have in their past. Young age, I wanted to clarify that. So that, think of this as a young age at the first offense, because your age can change, so that kind of becomes dynamic. Good examples of dynamic risk factors are a lack of insight into one's capacity for violence, a tendency to be angry and hostile in interpersonal situations, psychotic symptoms such as delusions or hallucinations. Remember, a delusion is a false belief system that is rigidly held. And hallucinations can be in any of your senses, but that's a sensory perception in the absence of a stimulus. Impulsivity and unstable negative emotions, and resistance or lack of response to treatment. So, man, I'll tell you, a lot of the guys I see in that forensic hospital, man, they are delusional. They think that people are out to get them. They have delusions of persecution. They think that the government is following them and people are stealing their money, and no matter what you tell them, they believe this. And they're also having hallucinations. It's really, I mean, if you've never really had any contact with somebody that has hallucinations, and you can physically see them responding to internal stimulus, whether it be voices, typically, that's the most typical, and then a little more rare is seeing things. And it can be, again, this is something that kind of falls into your professor's category of scary and fascinating.